Right, welcome back. And we are now going to take evidence from our second panel of witnesses this morning. I'd like to welcome Karen Watt, who's the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council, good morning, and Professor George Boyne, Principal of the University of Aberdeen, who's representing Universities of Scotland. So with our questions this morning, can I kick off with Stephen Kerr, please?
Yes, thank you. We've already heard this morning the importance of the revenue that comes into the sector through international students. So if you don't mind, I'd just like to ask you, in stark terms, what is the financial impact of the 17,000 additional students that we now have in the Scottish universities since 2016? Maybe Karen, you could go first and then George.
Of course, thanks very much. International students are an incredibly part of the dynamic mix of a university. And they add significantly not just to the student experience, but they are part and parcel of many internationally and globally significant institutions that we have in Scotland. So what we are seeing in terms of finances and the budgets, we have seen an increase, a steady increase in the amount of income being generated from international students. Now, that varies very much across the sector, so some institutions, some universities are more reliant on SFC funds than on international fees. But we're getting to a point clearly where there's a crossover in the amount of public funding that we put in for learning and teaching and the model in some universities that are becoming more reliant on international fees. Now, I would say that we will always see an element of cross-subsidisation, so we will always see some universities generating that kind of income in order to fund a range of research activities. Also, there will be an element of cross-subsidy for public teaching and for funding Scottish students. So I would say we'll see an increase. Now, clearly, one of the risks in all of that is that global markets change, international markets change, and each university will have to come to its own view about what its business model is, how it wants to fund its activities, and how it sees itself on that global competitive stage. And Scotland's not alone in this. There are so many universities across the globe that are reliant on that flow of international students and compete on a regular basis.
The word reliant, so yeah. Just how fundamentally important are these international, particularly the increment? I mean, if we went, for example, we went back to 2016 numbers in terms of international students, what would the impact of that be?
We have seen a significant increase.
Yeah.
I can give you that. I haven't got the actual figure to hand, but we are seeing that very significant increase. And what is also important is that every year we ask, as has been part of our recent, our kind of delving into more significantly the forward projections of universities, we are seeing many universities increasing or projecting an increase in that income over
further
time.
Further increase
over time. Now, not every institution, but many. And that will partly because of the strategies that institutions employ themselves, what their appetite is for increasing, for example, the research base where they will...
Is it to do the business model? I mean, does the business model collapse without an ongoing increase in the number of foreign students in Scotland?
So I would say that it is an integral part of most universities' businesses that they will look for international students, they will look for international income, research fees, whatever it is. Now, you know, in the round, I would say that is very attractive for Scotland. It's bringing in talent. We would like to see that talent stay, and we would like post-work visas that enable those students to stay and contribute more into the economy. But yes, we are seeing an increase in international student fees.
George, I'm quite interested to find out how dependent our current business model is in terms of its viability on international students. I think I'm hearing that it's like critically important.
So let me first reinforce the point that we're proud to have so many international students. In Scotland, this contributes to our international reach or soft power. We contribute across the world by educating so many international students. But it is also critical, as you rightly say, to our financial viability. The financial sustainability of Scotland's universities depends on the cross-subsidy from international students. You've seen the numbers and discussed them briefly this morning already. You know that our funding per undergraduate student from the Scottish Government has gone down by almost £2,500 in real terms since 2014, that our research income has also gone down in real terms, or research funding, and therefore we're compensating for that through the fees paid by international students.
And capping Scottish students, obviously.
To be clear, individual universities are not capping the number of Scottish students that we take. That's a Scottish Government cap to ensure that undergraduate education is affordable within the Scottish Government budget. So that's a Scottish Government cap, and we recruit to the cap. We take as many Scottish students
as we're
allowed to take. But then need to
have the revenue from the international students to compensate for the fact you're not getting the full cost of the teacher.
Correct. And this has been true for some time. And this happens in other education systems, not only in Scotland. So, for example, in England, our closest rival in higher education terms and comparator, for some time, international student fees have cross-subsidised research.
Mm-hmm.
The difference in Scotland is that international student fees are cross-subsidising not only research, but also undergraduate education, so that puts us under greater financial pressure.
So let's explore the vulnerabilities of that situation we find ourselves in. Karen mentioned them in passing, but George, how many Chinese students do you have at Aberdeen?
About 700.
I mean, we're dealing with real-world politics. We know the situation with China is very precarious, very difficult. In a worst-case scenario, we might not have our Chinese student contingent in Scotland's universities. What's your reaction to that? I mean, these are contingencies I hope the university sector is planning on.
So global markets are unstable, of course, for a variety of reasons. COVID, war in Ukraine, cost of living crisis, and therefore our reliance, to use your expression, on international fees introduces more uncertainty into our financial situation. That does make it harder to plan, does make it harder to be confident about what we're able to afford from one year to the next, and certainly over a period of 5 years, when we see what looks like a flat cash settlement, we are then needing to pay very close attention to what's happening in international markets, and it becomes more difficult to put in investment that would be sustainable over the five-year period to invest in our students and to invest in our staff, which is those are our two main priorities.
So you've got...
Karen, would you like to respond?
Yes, I think for us, again, the issue will be each institution needs to think how exposed they are to particular markets. They will be looking at diversification strategies where they need to. And it is something that we're tracking as well, because clearly there is, there are, as you were saying, some volatilities in the wider international environment. What we are seeing is a number of institutions looking at where they have particular concentrations in particular countries, and they are, as we understand it, diversifying into a range of other countries as well.
I'm just anxious about that exposure. I mean, for example, Aberdeen has got a Confucius Institute. How much income comes to Aberdeen through hosting this Confucius Institute?
Very, very little. A couple of posts are funded from China, so the funding for those posts come in. But
posts for teaching Mandarin.
Yes, yeah. As you've raised the issue of Confucius Institutes, I have never experienced even a hint of an attempt to influence university policy, either when I've been at Aberdeen or in my previous institutions. I've experienced no attempt to put any pressure on us to do one thing rather than another from a Confucius Institute.
Thank you. I think we can take that
Yeah, I don't want to go down the Confucius Institute.
I don't want to go down that rabbit hole either this morning.
However, it is a very important subject, which I hope we will return to at some point. But the University of Aberdeen has strong financial links with Qatar as well. And I dare I say, not the most attractive of regimes in Qatar. So, I mean, can you just talk us through the ethical dimension of the revenue streams you secure from international marketplaces?
Well, I would say there are ethical challenges in any international joint venture. It is not our purpose at Aberdeen to stay in a little corner in the northeast of Scotland and only interact with people whose values are identical to ours. Our purpose is to interact and to educate and to enlighten, and we think through international collaborations we contribute to that.
And I think in the answers that you've given to my questions, I think you've fully explained the vulnerabilities and how precarious the current business model is for Scotland's universities. So I thank you for that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kerr. I've got some supplementaries on this, as you can imagine. Willie Rennie first, please.
Karen, you've said on a number of occasions that the universities would come to a view that they'll make an assessment about their exposure to international students. But do they really have a choice? I mean, when the funding over the 10-year period has been cut or will fall by 37%, and when student places in Scottish universities are underfunded between £4,000 to £7,000, depending on the course that you're studying, do they really have a choice about coming to a view? Do they not have to do this to survive?
So I think as a funder, we look at a range of different indicators about, is our public money working to best effect? And we look at the financial sustainability of the sector and individual institutions. We look at the quality of outcomes for students. We look at how well those students are, what experience they have in learning in their learning and teaching. We look at the contribution that institutions make across the range of social and economic indicators, and we look at their international reach and their reputation. And all of those factors are suggesting that we have a sector that is, yes, under a lot of pressure, and yes, it will be looking at where its income comes from, but it's also thriving, and we have thriving institutions both individually and collectively. So I suppose at some level the answer to your question is yes, there is an inevitability about universities looking for additional sources of income that will generate surplus for them, and they will cross-subsidise always, I guess, their activities. If we're actually looking at whether we think we've got to a point where we are at risk in the university sector, I would suggest we still have a thriving sector, and it is still continuing to deliver across a range of different important indicators for us.
But you may have heard the evidence from earlier on about student homelessness, shortage of accommodation, staff pay, pensions, short-term contracts, staff ratios, you know, huge stress. And then now we hear we've got massive cross-subsidy, and it's massive cross-subsidy, more than is in England, where the funding from international students helps with research. Here it helps with Scottish students. So international students are doing it. Isn't it a little bit complacent to say that the sector is thriving when we've heard that pretty dark story this morning?
So don't misunderstand me. There is no complacency, particularly from a funding body that is effectively here to champion the best in our college and our university sector. So our advice to government is based on those kind of indicators that I talked about before, about sustainability, about how much the balance in funded, the number of funded places and how much we pay for a funded place. So, for example, we have increased the number of funded places over the last 5 years so that we have 5,000 additional opportunities for people in Scotland to study at a Scottish university. Now, those places are funded places. It is always a balance and a negotiation with government, with the university sector, about what the balance might be between how much we pay for each of those units of learning and teaching and how much demand there is in the system that we can meet. And it is always going to be a difficult set of choices around all of this. Last year, we were able to increase the price that we pay per unit of learning and teaching, albeit that was about 1.5%. So in terms of keeping up with the costs, there are cost pressures on the sector, inflationary pressures, the issues that students are facing on a daily basis around mental health and well-being, the accommodation crisis, all of these things, we absolutely understand the pressures that are there. As a funding council, our job is to work with the government about what quantum they're willing to invest in the sector, and when we have that quantum, how best to distribute it.
One final question. Are we comfortable that we're asking students from some of the poorest parts of the world to subsidise Scottish education to such an extent? African countries, South Asian countries, some of the poorest, most struggling countries, and we're asking them to subsidise Scottish education to this extent. Is that, do you feel a bit uncomfortable about doing that?
So we are investing in Scottish education. We are funding places for Scottish students. And, well, it's cross-subsidy across a range of different... And, of course, there will be an element of a moral dilemma, as you place it in that kind of term. But I think we have to hang on to the fact that these are also international students that are benefiting from a very high-quality opportunity at a Scottish university, very research-intensive, great learning and teaching opportunities. So I think we need to put it in that context as well. And we are benefiting from having students from across the range of countries at Scottish institutions. I think that there are clearly pressures and strains, and we are all trying to balance that the decisions that we're being asked to make, even as we distribute those resources, between demand, widening access, ensuring that institutions are sustainable, and those are issues that we wrestle with universities and the government on a not just an annual basis but on a regular basis.
Okay, thanks.
Do you want to contribute to that, Professor?
Yes, please. You're right to say that Scottish universities have been thriving. The most recent university league table was published just this last weekend in The Guardian, and five Scottish universities are in the top 20 in the UK. So we have been thriving despite the inadequate public funding for our undergraduate students and for our research. We've been thriving through the cross-subsidy from international students. My question would be, if the public funding, which has helped us to thrive, it's not as much as we would have liked, of course, but we recognise the budgetary challenges, if the public funding falls significantly over the next 5 years, if it's flat cash when inflation is in double figures, how can we possibly continue to thrive with that kind of cut in the real value of our funding? That's our concern. We want to be able to continue to thrive, contribute to Scotland's economy, to society, to the climate emergency, with all the wonderful things we've been doing so far, but that will become much more difficult with a very significant cut in the real terms value of public funding. That's our concern. That's why we're here today.
Thank you very much. Michael Mara.
Thanks, Camilla. In the years I've taught at universities, I have to say international students have made an unbelievable contribution in the classroom, I think, to the richness of the learning and the diversity that's in there. So it's a pleasure, frankly, as a teacher, to have those international students in the room contributing to those conversations. I do worry that we are not planning for the kind of, and how difficult it is to plan for volatile markets and the pressures we've heard about this morning from colleagues around the housing market. I think about school places for children, for students coming into the country. And what you're telling us now is that this is going to continue to increase, the demand, the need for universities to increase these numbers. Are we planning our social infrastructure to cope with these pressures?
Who would like to go first?
Karen. I think that is an absolutely core question for us. I mean, clearly that is slightly beyond remit here for us. But I think when we're looking at this, we need to be looking at institutions within place. So they are in geographical places that they need to think about that broader community impact and the contribution that they're making. I think there's a broad set of issues for us around how we support students more generally. So when we're talking about social infrastructure, I think we're looking at whether there is sufficient support for learners who are actually dealing with a range of very difficult pressures at the minute, and whether that's sufficient in and of itself. But it is constantly that balance between housing supply, housing demand, place in a city. This is why universities are so integral to the regional planning that needs to be much broader than that essence of a Scottish student getting a place. So
it doesn't really feel like it's working at the moment, given some of the evidence we've had today. And maybe I understand it's not particularly on your desk, Cameron. Professor?
If I just turn to the institutional infrastructure at university level, what we're seeing is the level of need for support rising per student because of the consequences of COVID, mental health pressures accelerated and deepened by COVID. We have more widening access students, and we're delighted to have them, really pleased with the progress that we've made, but they also need more support per student. So on the one hand, we have support need per student going up and flat cash and real terms going down. This is an almost impossible problem to resolve.
But on the pressure on social infrastructure, housing, education in the city of Aberdeen, primary school places for children of students who've come to Aberdeen, do you feel that you plan? It doesn't feel to me like those pressures are being planned for appropriately.
To be fair, we work closely with the city and the Shire Council and the Health Board and the organisations around us to try to coordinate the existing infrastructure. But you're asking an interesting longer-term question about whether investment in that infrastructure is being made, and that's also a challenge for the priorities of government.
Thank you very much. I think let's remember that Professor George Boyne is here not just from Aberdeen, but he's here to represent all of the universities, if you don't mind, today. We heard a little bit about some of the mental health challenges, specifically in some of your statements there. But the mental health counsellor funding for colleges and universities is about to run out this year. And it's funding that isn't confirmed, and if it's not confirmed, excuse my scribbly notes, the potential to lose 80 trained counsellors across the sector. So given the pressures you've just spoken about, is there enough adequate support for our students who are struggling and who have needing a bit more support than perhaps others are? And what barriers, what are the potential solutions can you see around that, or options that we have? Karen.
Shall I go first on that? Yes, the Scottish Government did commit additional funding for mental health counsellors. We distributed that funding, and that was part of the four-year funding settlement. So probably around just shy of £12 million has been spent on that. And that, as you say, about 89 additional mental health counsellors were provided through that. At this point in time, we're still in negotiation with the government about that particular programme, because clearly institutions have often employed people in their support services to provide that. And we're discussing with the government whether that can continue. My understanding is the government is putting together a student Mental Health Action Plan, which it's planning to publish, I think, in spring next year. And partly the reason for doing it in that way is that there are many avenues in government funding portfolios that might be relevant to the challenges that students are facing. But yes, we're still in discussions with the government about whether that funding will continue or not.
Thank you for clarifying that, Karen. Can I now hand over to some questions from Ruth Maguire, please? Oh, wrong buzzer. There we go.
Dialing in. There we go. Thank you, convener. Good morning, and thanks for being with us. I appreciate your contributions so far. I asked the first panel about the cost of living crisis and specifically the impact on students. Initially, highlighted an example of a constituent of mine, the impact on that cohort's university experience in terms of turning down placement opportunities and on occasion not travelling to lectures. I just wonder if George could respond to that, and is that something that you're seeing within your own university and amongst the universities you're representing?
I haven't heard of an example exactly like that. I'm not surprised to find that students are under these pressures. We have, I think, in all the universities in Scotland, hardship funds, which are specifically for these circumstances. And in addition, during the pandemic, some of us at least raised extra funding from our alumni community to support students in financial difficulty. So I want to record my thanks to the generosity of the graduates of Scotland's universities for stepping in and helping where students were in that position. So I think support is available, especially for those in greatest need. Of course, within a very tight budget context, it's difficult to ask for too many things simultaneously, but to see the financial support for students stepped up in line with inflationary pressures would be very welcome.
Convener, with your indulgence, the specific example that I raised was of a cohort who actually receive living costs grants, and the issue was about them not being classed as students when they were on their placements. Is that something you'd come across, and can you think of any potential solutions to that?
It's not something I've come across, but what I'll do after our session here is check with my University of Scotland colleagues whether that's a problem which is arising across the sector.
Thank you, that's helpful. And moving on to staff, I would be interested to hear what your reflections are on the impact of the cost of living crisis on staff.
So the impact on staff in universities is similar to the impact for employees across the economy. Wages are not keeping pace with rising prices. That's not something that we are comfortable with, but we have to deal with what's affordable. As a sector, we're only able to offer a pay rise according to our means, and therefore we are linking back now to the discussion about funding. If funding is flat for years ahead, this will make affordability even more difficult and bring extra pressures for institutions and for our staff, because it will be very, very hard for us to get anywhere close to the rate of inflation in the pay deals that we're able to afford to offer.
And not in any way diminishing the financial challenges. Is there more that universities can do to support staff through this and to support them as they deliver that increased support to, for example, the widening access students that you've mentioned?
We're all in constant discussion with our trade union colleagues and staff more broadly about how to adjust workloads in order to relieve the pressures. But the greatest difference that we can make to workloads is to have more people to share the work. Mm-hmm. And the argument here is exactly the same as on pay. With flat cash funding, it is correspondingly more difficult to recruit more staff.
Okay. I don't know if Karen wished to say anything on those matters.
It's a very difficult one because as a funding body, employer-employee relations aren't our thing, but we do look very carefully at the cost pressures. So from a point of view of sustainability and looking at the future, we do look very carefully at how that's working across each institution. And there are clearly big pressures around cost of living, pensions, salaries that we look at on an ongoing basis to look at what effect does that have overall on the sustainability of an institution. So, yes, it's very difficult times.
Okay, thank you.
And we have a supplementary on this from Michael Mara, please.
We had a series of college principals in front of us last week, and they were telling us that the Scottish Funding Council were asking them to assume for a 2% uplift in pay. And you're talking about monitoring the... I mean, in their view, I think in the view of everyone, that's deeply unrealistic. It's not happening. So, I mean, you're not making those same assumptions about universities, are you?
So I did watch the session with college principals, and I did hear them talk about our unrealistic assumptions. I think, so for us, particularly with colleges and universities, we work with college finance staff and principals to agree what kind of assumptions they should put into their forward projections. So that 2% at that time, and we're talking probably summertime, was what we agreed with the sector. However, they are modelling more significant and different kind of assumptions now. So the projections that we're going to get in the next few weeks will have a range of different scenarios. And that is clearly our expectation, that there will be more cost pressures and other kinds of constraints in terms of pay and pensions that all institutions will be dealing with. So we have looked again at our work with institutions on the kind of assumptions that are underpinning, given the shift in cost assumptions, and that's incredibly important. So it's a very dynamic, it's a very fluid situation. If you were to ask me at the start of the summer where I thought some of the assumptions might lie, and now they would be quite different, so that's why we work very closely with each institution. It is also the case that we are looking at what that might mean in the longer term. If it is a flat cash settlement, we have those assumptions, but we at this point in time don't yet know how the government will come to its range of pressures, and we will only know that over the next few weeks. We have an emergency budget situation coming up after the UK government's fiscal event, so we'll see what comes from that. And clearly then there's normal budget
setting.
Pushed
back a month, not that emergency by the sounds of things.
Okay. And then there's the usual budget, annual budget settlement, and we will recalibrate as we go.
Okay. Thank
you very much for those responses. Can I move on to some questions from Bob Doris now, please?
Thanks, Convener. I do want to touch on funding later on in my questioning, but I say that at the start because I appreciate the significant challenges that are there in asking this question. Ruth McGuire, my colleague, spoke about the widening access agenda, and there is a good news story to tell. I gave the figure in the last session that 18-year-olds from most deprived backgrounds are up 32% additional offers since 2019. That's a staggering figure. Now, obviously, they won't all take those, but it means we're now well ahead of our target to get 20% from the most 20% SIMD deprived areas in university as a proportion of students, and we're at 16.7% where we met our 2021 interim target early. So lots of good news stories there. Of course, the concern is that those from the most deprived backgrounds may be the most susceptible to the cost of living crisis. So I'm wondering what can be done to identify those young people, without stigmatising them, of course, but identify those young people and, through their learning pathway, offer whatever support you can. Because I appreciate that tick box, first outcome is we're getting more from deprived areas into universities for a first degree on a full-time basis, but the outcome we really want to see is them to graduate and be successful learners and enter into really positive careers going forward. So that's only half the story, is the input. The real outcome is the successful securing of the degree. So I wonder if maybe Professor Boyne can say a little bit more about what support is, despite the financial challenges, what support is being identified, is being used and deployed right now.
So across the sector, we provide support with transition to university and or widening access students potentially benefit from that. In addition, and you're quite right, it's really important not to stigmatise the widening access students by separating them out, but we know on our systems who they are, So we try to ensure that they get the right pastoral support as well as educational support through their degrees. This does again link nicely to the previous points that we've been discussing, but of course this requires extra resource to provide the extra support, and we're happy to do that because we're delighted to be on track towards the widening access target, but there is extra resource required in order to ensure that they progress, that they continue and complete their degrees successfully. And I say that as someone who was a widening access student decades ago, first in family to go to university. So I understand what it's like, perhaps, to need to work part-time in order to complete a degree successfully.
Now, we'll come on to funding, but I'm interested in what Karen Watt's reflections are on that success story and how we offer that important support through the learning journey. So any comments you have on that would be very welcome. And what monitoring might take place through the course? So a successor committee of this, I'm sure, Convener, will want to know in 4 years' time, all those young people entering SIMD 20 this year, what percentage of them successfully graduated vis-a-vis the average graduation levels? That's the kind of thing we're going to want to look at to see if it's been a real, actual success.
I think you're touching on a hugely important and significant aspect of this. So I think the achievement of the interim target is phenomenal. I think that's fantastic. We know the outgoing widening access commissioner said the next bit is the hard bit and that there is significant work still to be done. In our funding, we have premiums and additional support that we put into our funding model to support widening access students. Whether or not that is sufficient is another question, but we do recognise that there are additional costs, not just in supporting students from more deprived areas while they get to university, but in the journey to accessing that opportunity. We spend a lot of time and effort, and we have at least £30-35 million worth of programme money wrapped up into how that senior phase transition works and those pathways through into both college higher education, because while we're focusing on widening access for university students, there is clearly a significant amount of students who go through a college route who access higher education and get extremely good quality higher education at college, and who then can transition into a university either at year two or year three. And it's those points of transition that we're interested in. How successful are they? What's the success rate longer time? We will be tracking that. There will be a new widening access commissioner who we'll work very closely with on how we monitor that proportionately, but to get those outcomes and to know how that's really working.
Karen Watt, it's almost like you anticipated my final question, Convener, you'd be glad to hear, for time constraints, but we are currently conducting an inquiry into college regionalisation, the successes thus far, yes, and next steps, and you're right to mention colleges in relation to widening access. I think 40.9% of all full-time first-degree students are either studying in colleges or came through a college pathway into a university education. College principals have told us that HNC, HND year one, year two equivalence for university education, the reimbursement rate that they get for those students is less than universities get. And you'll understand that they're seeking a parity of financial support. I want to address that question to Professor Boyd, because I don't expect him to be arguing for a smaller slice of the cake going to universities, but it's a very real issue for college principals, and they might not think there's an equitable system in relation to...
I'm very happy to pick up that issue, perhaps not quite in the way that you're anticipating, because there's something really important here.
I know.
Which is that the funding per student in almost every part of the Scottish education system has gone up in real terms, including colleges, secondary schools, primary schools. The only part of the Scottish education system which has seen a real terms cut per learner is higher education.
Professor Boyne, that's helpful. That I suppose, within that answer, that still acknowledges there remains a gap between the funding at university and the funding at college. I'm not trying to create a division. I'm merely mirroring the comments we've heard from college principals, which is reasonable to do as part of our inquiry into that and overall budget scrutiny in relation to the sector. So, Karen Watt, is that narrowing of the gap deliberate to make sure that, is the end point going to be parity of funding?
So we did a review of tertiary education and research in over the last couple of years, and we explored all the different options for how do we fund. And again, it is an ongoing dynamic for us just now that we're looking at quite closely. When we fund colleges and universities, we're clearly looking not just at the funding per student, but the infrastructure that depends on that kind of supports that quality of learning and teaching. In some universities, clearly, it is more expensive because there are lab costs, there are a variety of different infrastructure costs, and so our funding partly recognises those different infrastructure costs. But it's clearly something that we are working very closely with colleges on when we review our funding models, for example. So there are opportunities to look at this again. But I wouldn't want us to lose sight of the fact that there is an incredibly important role that colleges are playing in higher education in ways that provide pathways to university or into a job at a kind of below degree level or at a higher national qualification. And those qualifications are going to be increasingly important for the economy. So I think when we look at our funding formulas, we're very aware of the pressures in colleges, and we are open to looking at how we fund in the future.
Can I just check, therefore, Convener, when you do look at that, because colleges would talk about the infrastructure costs of doing a lot of community work to bring those least likely to ever set foot in any forum of further or higher education setting into that setting in the first place, and that's a significant cost that they bear to get people into the system in the first place. So when you look at that wider infrastructure additional cost that sometimes universities have, or you look at those same wider infrastructure costs that community colleges also have?
So I guess I would say that we, in our funding, we recognise that there will be programmes for people that need to, if you like, get that first step across a threshold to even get into some form of education. So we recognise that there will be funding that's required, and part of our funding goes into that and acknowledges that. But if you're looking at parity of esteem, I think we're talking about a much broader set of issues than the funding model. We're looking at how parents think about colleges, how students come to it, and we're looking at how employers value different kinds of qualifications that come out of it. But you're right to say we're looking at all of our funding just now, and we'll be looking at that in the light of not just the budget and the spending review, but in terms of how we help pathways between colleges and universities and that form of collaboration that we are encouraging at a regional level.
Thank you, and perhaps you're here next week, Karen Watt, so we might get the chance to investigate that further with the college inquiry hat on. Can I move on to questions now from Graham Day, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I've got two questions, one for each of the witnesses. The first one's for Karen Watt. Budget scrutiny time, invariably parliamentary committees are confronted with a list of demands from various stakeholders and dire warnings about the consequences of not having those asks met. So I'm really looking to get a feel from you, Karen Watt, assuming that you come at this from a balanced perspective. Professor Boyne earlier said that given the flat cash settlements that are being predicted, the universities will be unable to continue to thrive. Is that a fair assessment?
So I wouldn't want to minimise the challenges that are being faced here and the squeeze that is going on and the cost of living crisis, both for staff, students and what that means for institutions. So I think we are living in an incredibly pressured time for colleges and universities. If you were to ask me about the last set of accounts, for example, or consolidated accounts we had from universities, if we looked at the academic year 21-22, we would see a huge underlying operating surplus, something like 370 million. Now, that might give you the impression that we have an extremely well-placed university sector, But everything is what happens below the line. So we know that two universities, Edinburgh and Glasgow, make up the vast majority of that surplus. We know that there are currently probably half a dozen universities that are looking at underlying declines in their surpluses and are posting deficits. We know that the surplus that I just quoted there of 370 million is going to decline very sharply. We've got projections that we've just had in from all Scottish universities, and that those surpluses are going to go down quite significantly because of staff pay, pension costs, because big capital projects where universities got funding for it are going to start spending out, city deals, whatever it is. And so the trends are looking like there will be a tighter squeeze. That is absolutely our judgment on all things. At this point in time, we have a remarkably resilient sector. When you look back even 2 years to the COVID period, we genuinely thought at the start of the COVID period we would see a fairly significant, not just shock in the university finance system, but we thought there might be some kind of chaotic collapse. We were genuinely so concerned because we had no international students coming in, conference stuff stopped, the residential model is based on students coming and staying, and so there were, you know, and labs stopped doing research in the way, and of course that shock to the system was significant. Now, we did put additional money in and we worked with the sector on all of this, but universities themselves adapted astonishingly well in a very, very difficult situation. Now, I don't for a second suggest that there isn't a very difficult set of spending review and budget and public expenditure issues coming up. But all I would say is there is a very significant track record of universities being rather brilliant at adapting to difficult circumstances.
Although in the interest of balance, if there is always a limit to the resilience that they will
completely
show.
Understood, and I think that is... For us, the issue about how we run close to the assumptions that institutions are making and why our advice to government matters around how much public money is required at different points in time for the university sector.
OK, thank you. A different question for Professor Boyne. University of Scotland, in the submission that we received, indicated they were looking for a minimum 171.7 million pounds. Now, the only identification of where that might come from was a fleeting reference to some small Barnett consequentials. You heard my questions to the previous panel. I'm sure you know exactly where I'm going with this. So, not in any way diminishing the validity of what you're looking for and why you're looking for it, where do you suggest in the current very difficult, you've acknowledged difficult financial circumstances, the government ought to find the sums that you argue for? We've already heard about the situation with the colleges as well, who've got a claim on any income that would, any money that could be generated. So are we talking about, have you identified something in the education portfolio budget that you think could be redistributed? Are we talking about reading other budget lines? I mean, UCU, to be fair, they talked about, you know, adjusting the taxation system and looking at the small business bonus. So they've at least made suggestions. What would you say to me on that?
So I think 2 points about this. First of all, what we're asking for is investment, because universities produce a fantastic rate of return on the money that's funded in them already, and would produce an even better rate of return if our budget ask is met. You've mentioned the Barnett consequential, and we've included figures in the paper for the rate of return to Scotland. If that Barnett consequential comes through to universities, there's a fantastic rate of return to the Scottish economy because we're able to pull in more money from UKRI and other funders. So extra money comes into Scotland because that Barnett consequential comes through to us. So this is about investment in our students, in our staff, in the rate of return for the Scottish economy and for society in Scotland. So that's my first point. Secondly, in a large budget, there is always some flex and room for focusing on priorities. And I'll give you just one example of that. We heard earlier in the previous session about the 10% extra for PGR students, PhD students, coming from UKRI. Not all of our PhD students are funded by UKRI. So what we've done in the University of Aberdeen is to match that for all our PhD students. And that has taken out of my fixed budget roughly the same percentage that we're asking for from the Scottish total budget, because we felt it was appropriate to invest in our PhD students, in their future, in their contribution to science, in their contribution to discovery, in their contribution to Scotland. So we found that money. Tiny percentage of my budget, equivalent tiny percentage of the total Scottish Government budget, is what we're asking for. There is always flex.
So in other words, somebody needs to look down the back of the sofa to find this ask that you've made.
Or achieve some efficiency gains elsewhere.
But you will appreciate, Professor Boyne, that everyone will be making that argument in a time of straitened financial challenges. Everyone can make a case, and you make a valid case. It's not as easy as that when it comes to finding the monies that you're looking for.
So I've complete confidence that the Scottish Government will look at value for money in the investments it makes, and our case sits very close to the top of the list, if not at the top of the list, in terms of the return on the investment.
Very well argued. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Professor, for that. Can I hand over to questions from Ross Greer now, please?
Continuing this line of question around finances, the challenge, of course, is I accept absolutely the economic and social return on investment in universities. The Scottish Government is currently, quite rightly, under pressure to expand free school meals, to increase devolved social security payments to something approaching the level of inflation, to keep public sector pay up in line with inflation. The Scottish Government is experiencing all these pressures in a situation where its settlement is a flat cash settlement for the coming years. Finance Committee yesterday, we had 8 organisations around the table who collectively asked for billions of pounds in spending, and all of them had a very, very good case to make. So going back to the questions I asked in the last panel, how can we justify giving Glasgow and Edinburgh universities large sums of public money when their reserves are not only considerably larger than what the Scottish Government is even allowed to hold in its reserves? So Glasgow's got £1 billion in its reserve, Scottish Government reserves capped at 700 million, not that there's anything in it at the moment. Edinburgh's got 1.8 billion in its unrestricted reserves, 2.8 billion in total. Glasgow's reserves went up about 150 million in the last report. Edinburgh's about 240 million. Why should we give Glasgow and Edinburgh University the same amount of money per student in this, just in the period of the spending review? Long term, I accept it's not sustainable and fair to give them less than other universities. But for the period of the spending review, while the government's got flat cash, should we really be giving every university the same amount of money per student when some universities have so much down the back of their own sofa?
Comment on the reserves issue firstly. The reserves are not free money. I won't comment on Edinburgh and Glasgow specifically, but for the sector as a whole, we hold reserves as a buffer against a rainy day, and there have been a few of those in the last few years. So it's important to have any well-run organisation holds reserves to deal with uncertainties that may arise. In addition, we held back a lot of our operational spending during COVID in particular, as an extra buffer against the difficulties that we were facing. Some of that operational spending will be released now, but it can't all happen quickly. And then thirdly, money has been borrowed for big capital projects, but not yet spent. So I think a lot of that money is actually committed. You've described some of it as uncommitted. I can't really check that without looking at the detail of Edinburgh or Glasgow's finances, which I don't intend to do. I need to clarify very quickly. So a lot of that money is already committed to stepping back up the operational spend as a buffer against further turbulence or to major capital projects that are in the pipeline, have not yet started, and which in fact will cost a lot more at current prices than was originally envisaged. So you may find that those reserves diminish, deplete very quickly. But there's a second argument that I want to bring in here. Every Scottish undergraduate student deserves to be fully funded, regardless of where they study. We shouldn't distort their choices by deciding to fund some undergraduates at some institutions to a higher level than in other institutions. I think we need fairness, parity, and for every Scottish undergraduate to receive the same support, regardless of where they study.
That's a perfectly compelling case, and you're right that the overall picture reserves, substantial sections of those are restricted. So Edinburgh's got £1 billion of restricted reserves, because it's got £1.8 billion of unrestricted reserve, though. But do you accept that the principle of what I'm saying here, that when the Scottish Government is under so much financial pressure across the board, but particularly on cost of living pressure on families at the moment, that it is a big ask for the university sector to be asking for a substantial amount of additional money when there are some organisations within the sector who hold in their bank account far more than what's available to the Scottish Government in terms of discretionary spend?
So the point of the ask is the rate of return on that investment, as I've explained, and I am going to absolutely hold to the position that every Scottish student deserves to be treated equally.
Thanks. And Karen, does the SFC do any monitoring of university reserves? Does that come under your remit at all?
We do look generally at the financial health of an institution, and we have a range of indicators that we look at, including the what we loosely term financial ballast, so that kind of that hinterland of reserves. George is right, quite a lot of those reserves are held for particular purposes and all the rest. But your question is a very fair question to ask at a time of extreme and difficult financial pressures. And in a way, I think it is very difficult for us as a mass funder of education not to have some kind of transparent funding algorithms that we use, that we adjust every year. What we don't do at the minute is we don't means test, for example, each individual university and try and get a kind of a negotiated outcome with that university for a certain number of funded places. That would not only be extremely complex to achieve, but I think would be extremely untransparent about how we actually fund. So I think there are real challenges to the point you're making. But I think the general point about how do we engage collectively at a time of peak challenge around public investment, around holding these balance of demands and desires that we have for the system to achieve what it needs to achieve. Therefore, you might assume we would not be looking to increase some of our funding prices at this particular time, and we may well hold to a position that we still want a significant number of Scottish students to be funded at the level that we're currently funding. But I think to means test on the basis of individual institutional financial viability is an extremely complex and possibly not quite philosophically fair approach to take. But I take the challenge in the round about how do we hold all of these different competing budget challenges.
One final question for Professor Boyne. You've heard in the last session discussion about my questions to the panel about working conditions in universities. So I think it's only fair that you have the opportunity to lay out University Scotland's position on that as well. So why do you think it's the case that there is this relatively high prevalence of casualisation, zero-hours contracts, short-term contracts, etc., within the sector?
So it looks to me that the figures are not that different from elsewhere in the UK. But if there is increasing prevalence over time, that's because of the uncertainty associated with the funding flows from international markets, which makes it more difficult to commit to a particular level of long-term investment. If we had more stability in the revenue arrangement, that would make it easier to be able to plan further ahead and know what our funding would be.
Thank you. I've got a quick question. It's round about capital funding, because we've heard from Professor Boyne there around reserves. We heard this morning about Glasgow University having to use a cinema for lecture theatres, and we've also heard about increasing student numbers. So the investment that's required in capital to facilitate this, I'm just curious as to your comments around the pressures on your capital budgets and how that might not support the increase in numbers that we're looking for in terms of the sector. Thanks.
So what we've done to respond to those pressures in recent years is to borrow money. to fund our capital programmes. I think that will become increasingly difficult as interest rates go up. So the capital programmes will be under pressure and under threat. We borrowed when interest rates were low, for the most part, across the sector. To be able to maintain that level of investment through borrowing will now be commensurably more difficult.
Thank you. Would you, are you?
Just very briefly, I think there is a real squeeze on capital more generally. We fund a certain level of infrastructure capital funding for universities, but it's relatively low at around, it's 37 million, and that is to cover some of the research infrastructure. We also have what we call financial transactions, which are low-cost capital loans into universities, very, very low-cost, and those are around, at the minute, I would say we've got about £30 million worth of that. But, of course, those are loans. They're very, very low-interest rates, and they're for particular purposes, particularly helping universities think about their green energy, low-carbon transition costs. But I think it is a... It's an ongoing challenge around how infrastructure works for universities in the round, not just physical, but digital and all that supports the kind of modern university environment.
Thank you very much for those responses. Can I move on to questions now from CoCab Stewart, please?
Thank you, Convener. So the Research Excellence Framework of 2021 results showed that Scotland's universities presented research judged to be world leading or of 4-star quality, and 86% was submitted was world leading or internationally excellent. Could either or both of you share some examples of good practice and what has led to that success, so that we can learn on that and build upon that, and if there's anything that can be done better, then that would also be helpful for us to hear.
Shall I start? And then,
please do, Karen. Yes.
So I would say one of the fundamental success factors is clearly the long-term investment that we have made in the research base in Scotland. You would expect a funder to say that, but we fund currently around £247 million in our funds go into university research, and we top that up with postgrad grant and university innovation fund, so it takes it to just shy of 300 million. And that infrastructure investment then enables universities in Scotland to bid for research projects in the dual funding system that we have into research councils and UKRI and Innovate UK. And actually, Scottish universities have been very successful in securing that additional funding. They have been extremely good at raising that research money per researcher per head of population. Scottish universities are extremely successful. The outcome of the research excellence evaluation process shows excellence not just world leading, but world leading in every single one of our institutions. And that, again, is not similar to some elements of the rest of the UK system. So it is phenomenal for Scottish institutions to be at that level of true excellence. I think that what we have seen is a brilliant ability to attract excellent researchers, because research is done by people as well as shiny labs and equipment and all the rest. So we have been extremely good at attracting good quality researchers. We have been good at pulling the thread through undergraduates into postgraduates and supporting people into early research careers. And we have increasingly been good at looking at how we use that infrastructure investment for bringing that research into impact and usefulness more generally. But I do think we need to think quite carefully about how that research money works in future, because our funding is still relatively flat and we still need to make sure that there are competitive aspects of this. We would like to see more collaboration in the research field. institutions are very good at collaborating together. We need to see scale and funding bids coming in that are going to really keep attracting that level of money. We've just launched a cross-disciplinary Alliances for Research Challenge, which in a small way is again pump priming that ability to get large-scale bids in to charities, with industry and to research councils to keep pulling that money in. But it's a very, very successful research evaluation process, and universities have done extremely well.
Thanks, Karen. George, have you got anything to add to that?
Yes, happy to. First of all, I agree with everything that Karen has just said, and especially that research is a long game. It takes long-term investment to generate these outstanding results, as you've pointed out. It can take 20 or 30 years to produce the research results, the impact, the quality of publications that are reflected at the very top grades in the REF. So the results we're seeing now, which were actually measured in 2020, reflect the work done in previous decades and the funding available in previous decades. The risk for us at this point is, will that funding continue and will it still be sufficient to produce that world-leading research? Mm-hmm. And if over a five-year period inflation continues to run high, none of us want that, of course, but should that happen, we're looking at our SFC funding reducing from about a third of our total revenue to 16 or 17%. Will it still be possible to support the really high-quality research that Scottish universities have undertaken?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. We know that despite the UK and the EU trade and cooperation agreement included provisions for the UK to keep participating in some of the EU programmes, such as Horizon Europe for research and Copernicus for space. And the Horizon 2020 has been worth sort of, €711 million to Scottish organisations since 2014. Now, we know that no agreement has been reached so far since the TCA was put in January. Has this impacted research already? Do you anticipate that it will impact? And what can be done to sort of get that moving?
Well, the short answer to that is a deal with the EU and Northern Ireland. If that could be resolved, then everything else would move. But clearly that's beyond our remit, or indeed the discussion we're having today. That's a much larger issue. There is a plan B from the UK government to provide approximately the same level of funding as from Horizon Europe. The university sector would prefer to remain in Horizon Europe for the European connections that provides to us, for the quality of the collaborations that we're able to access through that funding. So our first choice is still to be in Horizon Europe.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Do you have anything to add to that? I can
just to say that
I've got one
the
more
amount
Karen.
Of money that came in from EU funds was quite significant into the Scottish sector. So we would be concerned if we weren't seeing those funds continuing. And importantly, some of the research that was being done through the EU funding was particularly relevant to medical research, to engineering, bioscience, as well as some of the arts and humanities. So it would be a significant gap. But beyond the funding, the issue is one of partnership and collaboration. And actually, that had been an invaluable part of that. And universities are still reaching out. They're still part of European networks. But there is still a significant risk to that funding that we're keeping a very close eye on.
It's going to be a short question, because I've got two more people.
It's specifically for Karen, actually, regarding sort of like a quote that I've got here from the report from the Scottish Funding Council. And it was regarding the Research Council funding share and whether we should consider whether we're positioned appropriately to win new types of funding from the UKRI. I just wondered, how can we be better positioned?
So it's a really good question. I think that part of what we're trying to do in small ways, like our alliances for research, where we're pump priming about 600,000 for four projects over 4 years, is to encourage cross-collaboration, cross-disciplinary research alliances that can then provide bigger bids into research councils. One of the, I would say, however, that while we're quite good at getting money from research councils, our share has gone down, and we need to think about that with universities. The one part of UKRI's family structure that I think we could still do much more around is Innovate UK, where I think we are not getting a significant enough share of that money. In a small way, I think this is about how we understand the changes that are happening in UKRI, how we position with universities, how we make sure that there is funding to enable those bids to happen. I think keeping close on networks of influence around how UKRI is proceeding. But I think there we need a more collaborative, concerted effort around how we put consortium bids together.
We've got two more contributions, so I'm going to ask the members to ask their questions with no preamble. OK? Thank you. Michael Mara. So,
very keen on this focus on the long term. I mean, you just mentioned the issue there about the research capture from UKRI. The trend in that is not going in the good direction. It's going down, isn't it, Professor Boyd?
It's gone up very slightly in the most recent figures, but the long-term down trend is down.
And I suppose this is, I think what we're hearing is a lot of very concerning issues, and we could talk about almost the crisis. I mean, Karen Watt mentioned the peak challenge. You know, frankly, the Bank of England's just had to step in to bail out the UK pension funds. So it's getting worse. But the long term, I want to ask what you see as the prospects if we continue on the current path. That's what, as policymakers, I think we have to be concerned about, Convener. It's like the long term, the current path, where does that leave us?
I think we'll become more reliant on international student recruitment as our primary source of revenue for higher education in Scotland, with all the geopolitical and economic risks that that involves. It will make it more difficult for us to plan for the long term because of the turbulence and uncertainty in those income streams.
Me too. You can, but it's short, please. It's short.
And on the REF, I mean, the in essence, the England is improving at a faster rate than Scotland. Great results for Scotland. But again, long-term trend is not good.
Well, I guess you could look at it in a number of different ways. I think on a funder's, from a funder's perspective, what I'm interested in particularly is the increase in money for Research England and whether or not some of that comes across as consequentials and therefore whether we can put that back into the research base in Scotland. But the recipe for sustainability long term cannot simply rest on increased public money. It has to be a rounded view about what the sector will look like, including, I think, how universities and colleges work together around the nature of provision for learning and teaching, the nature of collaborations, and we are testing some of this in the northeast and in the south of Scotland. But long term, I think we need to look at coherent provision, I think we need to look at sustainability in a much broader way, and it needs to be whole sector, whole system, as well as institutions.
Thank you. I want to ask Willie Rennie for a very quick and final question this morning.
I'm afraid it does, again, reflect complacency. I mean, we have seen a massive reduction in the share of the UK research funding that we get for Scottish universities, from roughly 15 to 12.5%, 2.5% drop, £1.8 billion we've lost. Of course, you know, we shouldn't be wholly dependent on the public sector, but surely it's an indication of the fact that we haven't been funding in recent years to the same extent that they are in England. So why aren't you telling government that bluntly, that the brilliant Scottish universities with brilliant research are in decline?
So our review was very clear that we needed to not only protect what we had, but to grow the research base. So our review is very clear. It makes significant recommendations about this. So I think if we're looking at the future, we would like to see increased funding in the research base. That's undoubtedly true. We would also like to see industry and charities fully funding some of the research that is being conducted, so they make assumptions about whether the full cost is recovered or not. And I think we need to work out collaboratively how we put together compelling investment propositions for additional research that's coming through the councils. But I completely agree that there is a concerning trend and there's no complacency. There are recommendations about how we do this and about how we manage that inflow of additional funds where we possibly can. And through COVID, the government actually stepped in with around £75 million of additional capital to protect essential research while we were going through a very significantly difficult period. We would like to see significant funds being available for research in the future.
Anything else? Okay, that's fine. That concludes our session this morning. I want to thank everyone for your time today. We will have a brief 2-minute suspension now to allow our witnesses to leave. I will be leaving the chair and handing over to my deputy convener, Cocab Stewart, to convene the remainder of the meeting. Thank you very much.
Welcome back. Our next item on the agenda is to consider a piece of subordinate legislation, the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011, Rules of Procedures in Children's Hearing, Amendment Rules 2022. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure. It seeks to ensure that the rules regarding the composition of pre-hearing panels are consistent with the Children's Hearing Scotland Act of 2011. Does anybody have any comments to make on this SSI? Nobody has indicated that they wish to make any comments. Is the committee agreed that